So today is the third one in the series of the Exodus. And so it's the topic of the sanctuary. David the psalmist said, "Your way, O God, is in the sanctuary." If you want to understand God, you must study the sanctuary. It is a seriously neglected topic. The sanctuary does not apply just to an ancient people who were taught about the coming of the Messiah. It is about the people after the cross, after the Calvary, and particularly a people that are living at the closing scenes of this planet, which
us.
Means you.
You and me.
There was the giving of the law. When he led them out of Egypt, they were very vulnerable. They were very quick to complain. The moment the going got tough, they argued against Moses. Of course, they were really complaining and arguing against God. They may have heard of the law, they may have been aware of some of the aspects, but they really needed more than anything else to know God's will for them. And God at Mount Horeb, Mount Sinai, gave them, we talked about the meanings of the names, I won't repeat that today. God explained the answer to our sinfulness. And the answer is right there on the board. I am the Lord your God. Says everything. Has this wonderful sound. He says, I am the Lord your God. If he is the Lord your God, you will keep the law. Because if you don't, someone else is your God. Maybe you are your own God.
Some people like that.
The first thing that they needed was the law. You still need the law of God. Now more than ever, to believe that it was done away with is the gravest error you could possibly entertain. These people, they were used to slavery. They had to see the beauty of God, and the law was presented. And that is the transcript of his character. And when you look at that law, it is a royal law. And if you want to be royalty, you have to follow that law. Now there was another thing. You and I know how difficult it is to be good all the time. It's not easy. God knows our frailty. And as we know the law and we accept him as our Lord, that means he's in charge and ownership of our lives, and our God, the one that we worship, then clearly we need a system, we need a means to be empowered. The whole of the sanctuary is empowerment. You remember on the mountain, he said to Moses, let them make me a sanctuary. It is amazing that God did not drop out of heaven a ready-made sanctuary or temple. He could have, but he didn't.
In 52 weeks or something.
You make it, he said. But you make it according to the design. You must know what is required in and from a sanctuary. Let them make me a sanctuary. And the single purpose why he wanted So much. It was God who approached. You understand? It was God who said, I want to live wisdom. The God of the universe wants to live with us. It is not just about us living with God. It is about God wanting to live with us now. One day we will be living with Him, provided He lives with us now. And so, let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. How can a holy God dwell among sinful men? You remember the burning bush, the fire was burning, the presence of God, but the wood, the sinful humanity, was not destroyed. And that was a foreshadow of the sanctuary. God was going to dwell amongst His people. A sanctuary in the wilderness. When you come out of Egypt, you don't step into your new home. Between Egypt and your final destination, the heavenly Canaan, is the wilderness. And as surely as the ancient Israelites needed a sanctuary to be able to make it through that wilderness, you need what the sanctuary is offering for you today. Now you say the sanctuary is gone. It became the Solomonic Temple, and then later on, after some 400 years, it was destroyed. 70 years later, we have a Zerubbabel Temple, which became known as Herod's Temple, the one that Jesus visited. That one was destroyed in 70 AD by the Roman under Titus. We don't have a sanctuary. Yes, you do. The greatest realization is this. We think in terms of heaven. I hope you're listening to me. We think in terms of heaven as the better alternative. Do you understand? Heaven is not about being a better alternative. Heaven is your destination. It is your God-designed and God-given destination. That's where He wants you. Every one of you. There's no exception here. Heaven is a place right now. Heaven is a place right now where there is a sanctuary so superior to the earthly, unimaginably exceeding the Solomonic Temple and Herod's. There were just a faint reflection. There is a sanctuary in heaven which is the very best, the most holy place, where the best of sacrifices and the most holy priest, high priest, is working on your behalf. We think in terms of Jesus having paid the penalty, and that was our salvation. Can I suggest to you the very work that He is doing in the heavenly sanctuary above is as essential as the sacrifice that He made on Calvary. It is that important. Now, let's go into the details. When Moses there in Exodus 20, he went on the mountain and God gave him the particulars. God told him what it should look like, what it should be made of, what it should be used for. Everything that he did, everything they put together, was because of the instruction of God. The Ark of the Testimony. What was inside the Ark? The two tablets of stone with the Ten Commandments. Correct. To the Hebrew, the Ark of the Covenant was made up out of two pieces. The top, that or covering, and the actual chest itself. What was it made of? What was it made of? It was made, the box was made of acacia wood, but it was overlaid with gold inside and outside. You could only see the gold. The top there, this is interesting, the top here, this ring is beautiful. It's actually like, that is the closest reflection to the throne of God, because the Shekinah glory was always between those two cherubim. The cherubim represents the whole of the heavenly realm that are looking into the plan of salvation. The plan of salvation is not just for mankind. The plan of salvation is for the universe. The universe is learning about God, what he is like. They are learning about the nature of God. Still. And they look intently in what God is doing. That top there, that very top here, that cover is called the kaporit, ha-kaporit. That means the covering. It is also called a mercy seat. It is a mercy seat because it covers the law. Not to do away with the law, but to give a, what shall I say, a buffer between the sinner and the law. Because the breaking of the law that demands the blood, in which is the life, it demands the life of the sinner. Once a year, the Day of Atonement, the high priest would sprinkle the blood of the Lord's God, making payment for the breaking of the law of all of those who take his mercy and have surrendered to him. Every Israelite on that day had to earnestly search themselves. They were in prayer. It was the only compulsory fast day. They knew that that was a judgment. And it'd be tempting to go on about it, but that's what the meaning was. The ark, it's interesting that God begins with the ark. You know, we would start with a surround, a courtyard. We would then put perhaps that altar of sacrifice, after all, that would come first, and so it should. And then we would concern ourselves about the building proper. No, in the Hebrew thinks from effect to cause, not from cause to effect. Daniel 7 is about judgment. Daniel 8 is about priesthood. Daniel 9 is about the sacrifice. Can you see the reverse order? And so God begins with the ark, because this is the most sacred, the most holy item that was to be found in that temple. The mercy seat, the covering, the place where the blood can be spilled and it will pay, it will satisfy. The Shekinah glory of God. That was his, there were two aspects of God's presence. One of them was the light between the cherubim, and the other one, of course, was the column of smoke on top of the sanctuary. I'll show you an image in a minute. The law cannot be done away with. It is the character, the nature of God. It is as part of him as the fact that he is love. The atonement can only be effected because of the mercy seat. The throne of God, that would be the most, what shall I say, illustration of how God dwells and where he dwells. Communing with God, he was to speak from between the cherubim. You may not be in his presence in the most holy place, but you could stand in the holy place and you would hear him. No examples in the Bible of it happening, but it surely must have. Then we have the altar of incense, which was the closest to the ark, but it was divided, as I will show you in a minute. There was a curtain, there was a thick curtain, that thick, between the holy place and the most holy place, and that altar of incense was absolutely essential. This is probably what we should center on most on. The altar of incense is extremely important. It was only about 3 and a bit feet high. It was only about 1.5 feet in square. It was made of acacia wood. It was made of acacia wood, and it was overlaid with gold. And it's interesting that it went by the name of Altar of Incense, but it also is the place of mediation. Let me tell you something. The fundamental difference between the religion of Islam and Christianity is in principle that we have a mediator. You understand? We have a mediator and an intercessor. They don't. So the altar of incense is extremely important in our thinking. And the incense had to be burning continually. The incense was made up out of 4 particular type of raisins of equal proportion. It was known as a holy formula, never to be reproduced or made for any different purpose, not to be used individually anywhere else. That was the holy prescription of what the incense should be. The incense can only come free as it burns. The fire to ignite the incense came from where? It came from the altar of sacrifice. There were the 2 sons of Aaron, Nadab and Abihu. And they, of course, offered strange fire. They took fire from the cooking pot. They had been drinking a bit. Fire is fire. No, not to God. The validation of the incense laid in the fire, or where it came from. It came from the altar of sacrifice. The incense means actually the merits of Christ. Now, you must understand this. You know how you pray. You know how you pray. This is making a good noise. Do we want to change it, or there's nothing we can do? All right. That's it. I haven't said anything yet. The incense is the prayer. So the incense is the merits of Christ. You see, when you pray, here's something that you should know. When you pray, and I don't know how good your prayer life is. When you pray, it is not your prayer that is doing it for you. Although you should pray. Your prayer can only reach God if it has the incense of the merits of Christ. Do you understand? Your prayer, my prayer, need the merits of Christ. Even the Holy Spirit, although he can transform the prayers, with groaning and everything. It cannot be done without the merits of Christ. It needs the incense. The incense can only be brought forth because of the fire of the altar of sacrifice. Fire is the ultimate cleanser of sin. And that is the meaning of the fire on that altar. That's why they always used to burn it. Now, the incense with the prayers, only fire from the altar of sacrifice, the blood applied on the 4 horns. There are 4 horns on that altar. Both the altar of incense and the altar of sacrifice had 4 horns. The Hebrew word for horn, keren. It means horn, it means power. When the priest, the high priest, would put that blood of the petitioning nation. 95% of the cases, it was not the blood of the individual petitioner, but it was actually the sacrifice for the people, that the priest would take the blood into the holy place and he would put a bit on each of the horns. As I said, it means power. You know that hymn? There is power in the blood of the Lamb. That's where this comes from. Power in the blood of the Lamb. The blood applied on the four horns, validating the incense, was of course the fire that came from the altar of sacrifice. This is our protection. When on that occasion, once a year, on the 10th day of the 7th month, during the Yom Kippur, the high priest would go behind the veil, behind that curtain, as he would approach the very presence of God on that one singular occasion, he had to have with him a carrier for the incense. He had a container, if you like, that was full of incense, and the smoke of the incense is what protected him. It was a censer, you understand? He could not go into the most holy place and hope to survive. The meaning is, he needs the protection of the merits of Christ and the prayers that then will be acceptable. Most assuredly, Jesus said, you know, there's something you should realize. The people of Israel had no Bible. You understand that? They had, later on, they had scrolls, written scrolls. But these were not mass produced, because these were done by hand and they were very expensive and hard to get. So very few people could afford that. But the thing is, particularly in the Exodus, none of the books are recorded yet. The book of Genesis, most likely, I have no doubt about it, but it was not mass produced. So how could they, without a Bible, how are you going to learn about God? Now, there's plenty of Christians who try. They say they're Christians, they have a Bible and don't read it. That is not the way to go. But these people did not have. They only had the spoken word. That's all they had. But if you wanted to know about God, you would go to the sanctuary. And you learn how God saves you. And I hope that becomes clear as we continue. Here is the study of the sanctuary. Most assuredly, I say to you, whatever you ask in my name, he will give you. When he said, whatever you will ask in my name, can you see the meaning of the incense here? That's his merit. Give me another word for name.
Character.
If you ask of God what Jesus in your place would have asked for you, you'll have it. And it has the merits of Christ. Because he loves you and he wants the best for you. You know how often you pray and it's not really coming about. God may put you through a test or a trial. That is not that God doesn't hear you. He absolutely hears you because of the incense. He hears you, but the reply that you will receive may not be quite what you wanted to hear. And that means you may hear nothing. That doesn't mean that God hasn't heard your prayer. Please, and I say that to myself, spend more time in prayer. Mm-hmm. Use the incense that the Lord Jesus provides you. Pray more. Whatever you ask, I say to you, in my name, you ask the Father, he will give you. I like this statement here. Every true Christian will be strong, but never not in the strength and merit of his good works. You understand that? What we are teaching as a people, it doesn't matter how good you are, how hard you try, it can never be good enough. You need the intercession. You need the merit of Christ. Is that clear? That's where the strength comes from. It is in the righteousness of Christ. That's where you get your power. That was true then at the earthly sanctuary and temples. That is also so true, particularly here and now today. And that is in your lives as well.
Amen. Amen.
Which through faith is imputed unto him. It is the righteousness of Christ that you need, and it has to be imputed to you. Do you understand this? That's where your strength comes from. You can be strong. Don't say you're weak. No, you can be strong, but you need the intercession of the altar of mediation and intercession. Your priest in the heavenly sanctuary is none other than Christ. I'll show you the text in a minute. It is a wonderful truth that the ultimate sacrifice, God himself, is also your high priest. And he knows everything about you because he was fully human as you are now today. Seeing that we have a great high priest, Paul says, who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God. Your my great high priest is Jesus Christ. Any other earthly priesthood should be out of business. True, absolutely. But there is one God, one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. All the others should be unemployed. Because whilst I respect other people's beliefs, I'm not saying anything. The Bible is saying that you have one mediator. You have only one chance in this life to make it into eternity. You've got to go to Jesus Christ. That's where you have to go. The table of the showbread was magnificent. Beautiful overlaid with gold, made also of acacia wood. Two sets of six, so 12 loaves or cakes of unleavened bread. Did you know the only bread that they were allowed to prepare on the Sabbath was the showbread? The priest had to do it. The priest had to prepare it, and it had to be, here it is, it had to be on the Sabbath. They removed the old ones, and they would eat it in a holy place on site. The priest would eat it. It was meant to be only for the priest. There's one exception, David, on one occasion. But really, it had to be eaten by the priest, the old ones, every Sabbath. Here is the meaning. Every Sabbath, you would have fresh bread. Now let's have a look at the significance of the bread. The bread of the presence, it's the presence of God, one for each tribe. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. You remember Jesus saying, where was he born?
Bethlehem.
Bethlehem. What does it mean? The bread of heaven came down in the bakery. Where else? That's what happened. He says, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. It is man's dependence on God for material sustenance, physical sustenance, and spiritual sustenance. You need the bread that came from heaven. Do you understand that? Please let that sink in. You need the one who said, I am the bread from heaven. And then you will be fed. Replace every Sabbath. Here is not a good reason to keep a Sabbath. Every Sabbath, when you come here and you worship, and you worship and you let God speak to you through other speakers or people that he appoints or music or whatever it is, a scripture reading. When God speaks to you because you honor him to come on his holy day in this place, you come together according to his command, he will honor you and he will give you fresh bread. It's still warm. Are you with me? Absolutely. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever, and the bread that I shall give is my flesh. He offered his body, which I shall give for the life of the world. And that's Calvary and all the brutality that went with it. It also is the substance of what he taught. Everything that he taught. The golden lampstand, the menorah. Seven lamps. Seven is completeness. There are various numbers in the Hebrew that relate a perfection. Seven is really the perfection in time. 10 is in quantity, 7 is in time, if you can remember that. 7 lamps, you remember in the book of Revelation, the 7 lampstands, the 7 churches, right up to the end, covering the whole spectrum. The light of the world. Now, when you say that, you remember Jesus saying, I am the light of the world. This is what the sanctuary taught them. The sanctuary taught them all the biblical truths that you know, text by text by text by text. He says, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness. If you hate the darkness, start turning to the light.
He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. Your life will be so much more bearable if you can see where you're going. And also who's going with you. Very important. You are the light of the world. That represents the churches too, God's people throughout the ages, fullness of time. Because you are the light of the world. That's what Jesus said. The Sermon on the Mount. The 7 spirits of God, it also represents the 7 spirits of God. Let me show you where you can find that in the Bible. Isaiah 11. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, speaking of whom? Jesus. The Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of understanding, the Spirit of counsel, the Spirit of might, the Spirit of knowledge and the Spirit of the fear of the Lord. Start counting. The Spirit of the Lord is 1. The Spirit of wisdom is 2. Understanding is 3. Counsel is 4. Might is 5. Knowledge is 6. And the fear of the Lord is 7. There you have a completeness of the Holy Spirit. I need the Holy Spirit in my life. It is the Spirit, Jesus said, which gives life. The flesh profits nothing. He said, the words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. Can you see that? You need, I need. We need to submerge ourselves in the words that Jesus spoke. You need to have them in your mind. You have to have them. And the Hebrew would say on the heart. Of course, the heart is not the feeling. The heart is where the thinking is. They got to occupy your mind. It's a very safe way to travel, by the way. I like the example there in the book of Zechariah. There is Zerubbabel. They've come back from Babylon. They want to rebuild the temple and some dwelling places. And there are mountains on their highways so big. He can't look beyond it. And the man is discouraged. And he needs encouragement. And this brave man, this Zerubbabel, gets the message from the prophet. And the prophet says that God says, not by my might, nor by power, but by my spirit. God moves on you and me in our lives through His Spirit.
Amen.
Please remember that. That's what He does. It was true for Zerubbabel. It is true for you. Let me tell you something. The one who would light that menorah, trim it, make sure it kept burning all the time. It had to be burning all the time. The one who was responsible for that was the high priest. The priest had to make sure it was burning all the time, because what that represents has to be available into our lives all the time. Jesus said this. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper. God the Holy Spirit. He will send you another helper. That he may abide with you forever. That's really the role of the high priest, and it is reflected in what the seven candlesticks menorah actually represents, mainly the seven spirits of God, the Holy Spirit. We need the Holy Spirit, as we know, in our life. Nevertheless, he said, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. And he says, but if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. He says, but if I go, I will send him. The Father sends the Holy Spirit to you, and he sends the Holy Spirit to you. We just need to receive it. Do you understand this? And so, Jesus said, when he has come, he will convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Have a look there. Sin is dealt with in the courtyard. The courtyard represents the world that has no roof. It is an object lesson to the whole of the universe. The building of the tabernacle proper, the holy and the most holy place, has a roof. It represents heaven. Only the priest can go there. You can't. Jesus went to the heavenly one. He will convict the world of sin. Sin is dealt with in the courtyard. Righteousness is what you achieve because of the intercession in the holy place of the altar of mediation. And judgment finds place right there, once a year, the Yom Kippur, right there at the Ark of the Covenant. Can you see that this is sanctuary language? By the way, virtually all of your Bible can be brought back to the Hebrew sanctuary. That's how important it is. I will put, I love this one in Ezekiel, a short version. I will put my spirit within you. You understand, it's not an acquisition that we make or deserve, but he says, if you're willing and you so ask in his name, he said, I will put my spirit in you, cause you to walk in my statutes. You know, there's a way that you really can live the life that you know he wants you to live. You need the Spirit in your life. There is power, so much power available. And you will keep my judgment and you will do them. You will do them. You know why? Because you won't. Get it? People often say to me, they're bad habits, I can't give it up. I know. But whatever the desire is that causes the bad habits, that's the one you gotta give up. That's what you gotta get rid of. And then you lose the habit. If you want to live rightly with God and you keep doing it in your own strength, you will falter. And even if you are perfect, it wouldn't be acceptable. It has to be through his by his Spirit. That means born again. The tabernacle, I never can get a correct illustration of what it should look like. It doesn't matter. Every time I surf the internet, I simply cannot get the proper designs, the proper colors, and everything else. There's so much to tell, because we can't cover this topic in one session. But what was interesting, that one of the presences there, other than the presence of God in the most holy place between the cherubim, the Shekinah glory, it was also represented in the cloud that was above the tent, the tabernacle. At daytime it was a cloud, and it gave shadow where you would normally never find shadow. And at nighttime it will give you the heat, it will give you the warmth and the light. See, God gives what you need, which is not always what you want, that you have to get used to. That was magnificent. Of course, the tents of the Israelites were never that close to the tabernacle. There was at least 1.5 kilometer distance between the nearest tents and where God dwelt. And God said that I may dwell amongst them, that is fair. God did, right in the middle of them. But there was a reverent distance between the Israelites and the Holy God who dwelt amongst them. And so the tabernacle, there you have a inside of the first compartment, which really was the holy place. You can see the seven candelabra lampstand. You can see the table of showbread. You can see the altar of incense before the curtain. And you can see, of course, the Ark of the Covenant. This was very holy ground. If everything was overlaid with gold, it would have been magnificent. There are two light sources. There is a light source of the Shekinah glory from between the two cherubim that might have spilled over into the holy place, and you have the lampstand that was always on, and the reflection would have been magnificent, particularly when you consider the Solomonic temple. A minister of the sanctuary, of the true tabernacle, you know, it is so important that you understand the purpose, the meaning, and the employment of a intercessor, a priest on your behalf. Because then you understand what Jesus is doing for you now. It wasn't just an action in the past. Friends, it is what he is doing now for you, every day, today, tomorrow. It's what he's doing for you. A minister of the sanctuary of the true tabernacle. That's the heavenly one. The Lord erected it and not man. It's not on this planet. Who served a copy and shadow. All that was meant by that earthly sanctuary was to teach the people, you here today as well, what is happening up there. You gotta start thinking what is happening up there. What is going on? And particularly in the light of your salvation. Very important you get this. Who serve a copy and shadow of the heavenly things. It was only a copy that includes also the solid structures of the temples. Christ has not entered the holy places made with his hands, which are copies of the true, but he's gone into heaven itself and he still ministers to you. Wonderful. The courtyard is magnificent. I wish I had more time. When you came as a petitioner to the door of that courtyard, does anybody remember what the name of that? This is a door, you see.
Sha'ar,
yes. And what does it mean besides door?
Mindset.
It's a mindset. He's had a good teacher. Very good. When you step through here, when the priest lets you in, you couldn't just barge in. I don't know why they put the kids there, they weren't allowed. If you would walk in here, the representative of the family or himself, he would have to wait till the priest opens and he walks through the door. Now here's an interesting thought. Who said that? He is the door. Let me put it this way. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved. He is that door. He is the Lamb. He is the priest. He is the high priest. He is the sacrifice. He's everything. Christ is everything. No one can do it better or did do it better. And so you step into the mindset of Christ. The moment you step through that door, you would find justification. Justification. If you drop that, you would be right with God. If you carry on living, there is sanctification before there is a glorification. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Remember Jesus saying that? There is no other way. There is no one comes to the Father except for me. Please understand this. You will never make it into the heavenly Canaan if you don't go via Jesus. Is that plain to you? Do you understand what you owe him? What he's done for you? But more than anything else, my friends, more than anything else, what is he to you now? That's the important question. History of planet Earth, do you know that the sanctuary is prophetic? Won't have time to go into it, so I step over it. It's really his story. It is the story of Jesus Christ of this planet. This planet wouldn't be here without him because he created it. It wouldn't have survived the marring of the sin if he hadn't sustained it. And it would have no future It would have no future if he hadn't come and paid that penalty. And he's what he is today. The bronze laver was for the priest. It was a ritual for the priest and priest only, not for the common people, to clean their hand and their feet. So it was between the tabernacle and the meeting place. And it was for the purpose of cleansing. This is perhaps the most important article in the courtyard. The courtyard represents the world. What was it made of? We talked about this, I'm sure we did. What is it made of? It's acacia wood overlaid with what?
Pure gold.
Bronze. What is bronze? It's an alloy. It consists of two metals. What are they? The copper and the tin. So we have the copper and the tin. Copper doesn't rust, doesn't decay, it represents perfection. The tin is dross, same word in Hebrew. It's sin. You have to put the perfection of Christ and the sin of the sinner together. And they have to become one. I'll tell you why. I'll show you. A statement from the book of Ezekiel. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon himself. And the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon himself. You cannot transfer righteousness from one party to another. You cannot transfer sinfulness or sin from one party to another. You cannot transfer it. Though we call it. There's only one way. The altar of bronze in the courtyard solves the problem. The two shall become one flesh. That's why he became human. Can you see why he had to become human? Many more reasons, but that's one of the main ones. He had to become human because we can't become him. You understand? So the superior copper comes down to the dross of a sinful humanity. And the invitation is to hide in him. You have to hide in him. You have to hide in the beloved. Because the priest in most of the substance, most of the instances, for particularly the individual petitioner would take a small piece of the animal that was being sacrificed. You understand that the petitioner puts his hand on the head of that animal, confesses his sins silently. The earthly priest had nothing to do with it. And then he is involved in the killing, he kills it. He is involved in the preparation, it's quite involved, it used to be, of the animal. He gives his expression. Yes, he is guilty. And he gives his expression. Yes, I'm looking forward to the Lamb of God to come who will take away my sins. And in so doing, that animal became actually the sinner who died. And the priest would then eat a little bit of that flesh, just a tiny bit. And then he would go into the holy place. If it was an offering for the people, he would take the blood. And the blood goes in because the life is in the blood. But you know, the little bit what he ate, you are what you eat. Isn't that correct? And so he now, you and him have become one flesh. He has you in him. You understand? When Christ becomes your sin bearer, he has you with it. He has to have you, is it? There has to be a complete surrender. You've got to be completely a part of him, and you will walk through the heavenly courts, and he'll carry you through the judgment. Can you see the lessons to be learned from the sanctuary? The book of the Bible would not be big enough to write all the aspects of that sanctuary. It marvelous book as it is, the sanctuary told you so many stories. The substance, folks, is Christ. Christ is the substance. Jesus is our sanctuary. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I will build it up. Everything about that sanctuary, every bit, every utensil, every color, every material, every service, every ceremony was about Jesus. That's it. It taught them. I don't know why they didn't recognize him when they saw him, when he came. I still marvel why they couldn't get it. Because they had a wrong understanding. We're having no excuse. An attack on the sanctuary is an attack on Christ. It diminishes Christ, and I'll quickly show you why. The work that he did do, that is Calvary, as if you've seen those crosses with a Christ on it, or you see a crucifix with a Christ on it, it is telling you that Christ still is dying and supposed to be keep on dying for your sins. It wasn't a once and for all sacrifice that was wholly sufficient, yet that's what the Bible teaches. He couldn't be your priest if Jesus still has to keep on offering himself. He can't be your priest, and that therefore is wrong. Transubstantiation is wrong. When Catholicism, and I have to say this, when they promote the idea that there at the Eucharist they are crucifying, not crucifying, they are offering him again. The blood of Christ, the body of Christ. They are saying that his sacrifice has not finished, therefore he cannot be your high priest. Because the sacrifice comes before the priesthood. Are you with me? Does everybody get that? It's an attack on Christ. Because it certainly diminishes the work that he's doing now. So we have saints, and we have so many of them praying to dead people, good people that they might have been. But you know, it diminishes the work of your heavenly, one singular intercessor, the only one between man and God. Can you see how important truth is? When I learned this, I thank God for the truth. And the meaning that Jesus says, I am the truth. I accept that. And when he prayed to his Father in the 17th chapter of the Gospel, there of John, thy word is truth. Sanctify them through your word. You have to make it a priority to read your Bible. Study what Jesus taught. Read your Bible and pray. The power of prayer is yet misunderstood or under-evaluated. Christ was treated, I love this statement, Christ was treated as we deserve, that we might be treated as he deserves. He was condemned by our sins in which he had no share, that we might be justified by his righteousness in which we had no share. He suffered the death, really, that was ours, that we may receive the life which was his. I don't think there's a better statement that sums up the whole message from the sanctuary. This is sanctuary language, because that's what it taught. And so, grace. I like this one. Every once in a while you come across something like this. What does grace mean? How do you define it? This is a good definition. Make it an acronym. God's riches at Christ's expense. Really, grace is giving something that you don't deserve, correct? It's interesting that mercy, that's the other side, is something even better. Not giving something that is deserved. This is the message of the sanctuary. The sanctuary says God offered himself so that you don't have to die forever. I think that's a wonderful offer. That is indeed wonderful. Divine love triumphs over divine wrath by divine self-sacrifice. And so, man comes to the place where he recognizes that his life is most unsatisfactory. He finds himself attached to his idols, whatever they may be. He senses the uselessness of habits cultivated, past motives, whatever growth you cherish, past desires gratified, she realizes, this is not living. It's only existing within the capsule of your addictions. There's an answer. Man desires to reach the promised land, and he makes the journey with his presence. You need the sanctuary in your life. And you will reach, even today, you will reach the promised land. And may God bless you. Bring you there. And when we get there, we'll talk again. May God bless you.
We have a special item.
Thank you. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have made yourself known to us. But really, as the song said, we want to know you more. And not knowing you more is really our fault. We know that. We are so busy with self. We're so preoccupied by our wants. Forgive us the shortcomings. Help us, teach us how to ask in the name of Jesus, that we may receive and pass it to others. Give us that power that we look for in our life, because we really want to be with you. We want to dwell with you. There is no greater love that has been shown to anyone of a member of mankind than the love that Christ showed them at Calvary. Let us never forget what he bore for us on our behalf and for what he is doing on our behalf in the heavenly sanctuary. Lord, we pray that you teach us how to walk together with Jesus. Same direction, same destination, and the same desire. And so, Lord, bless this congregation, each and every person here. And as we will have the fellowship and we will have the food, we pray that the food may nourish our bodies and that the fellowship may affirm every person here, that there will be nobody here who will feel they're left out, because they are not left out. They are embraced in your love as well. And we want them to know we love them too. Help us to be what you want us to. Be with us now, Lord, and bring us together again for worship and study. In Jesus' most precious name we ask. Amen.
God bless you.